special person, Keith. How many people you know have been CFO of a public company, a CFO of a large division of another company, and then in charge of sales of the same company? Very, very talented man. Thank you for those kind words. I feel like I'm coming a little bit into enemy territory here. Now, everybody wants to talk about startups. I'm going to talk about non-startups. So with that in mind, let me go. So do a little introduction of myself, add some details that Keith did not. And then I'm going to talk about markets that are mature, what are the strategic imperatives in those markets, and what are the skills that you need to succeed in those markets. And hopefully I can convince you that those people that have been using their skills in startup will also be successful in using those skills in more mature industries. I will also, because I will explain to you, I think M&A is a very important part, a very important skill to have in a mature industry. And I'm going to do a primer on M&A skills. Questions. What I'd like to do is I will stop occasionally and ask for questions. I will not wait until the end. If I have been a bad person and have not stopped in a while, yell it out. I mean, this is a nice group, manageable group, and I would prefer to have a two-way conversation. So, a little bit about myself. Had a very, very odd education. Somebody called it an MBA in computer methodology, but it's probably an MBA in ancient history. I thought I was cool because I could program in 8, 9 languages, none of whom anybody in this room would even recognize. I did some auditing and consulting work at, also showing my age at what is now gone. I did spend some time at Anderson Consulting, which is now Accenture. 15 years as a supplier to the print industry. If there was an entrepreneurial or a startup operation experience I had, worked for a couple of years and built a $15 million distributor of, believe it or not, encyclopedias. But it was a successful company. 10 years building the company that Keith just referred to. It was a former local printer. We started with a $17 million company, went public, built it up to $2.5 billion, and then decided we needed to do something different when we grew up. We changed a lot. But during that period, provided superior returns to our shareholders. The last 10 years, been having fun as a boutique investment banker, working in the packaging and printing industries. That's how I've made money in my life. Other things I've done, I am a board member of a company in London, and we're recreating the USAA service model that we see on TV here in the US a lot. We're creating that in the UK and in Europe. I'm also on the board and an investor in a call center, which was one of my first forays out of the packaging and printing industry. I sit on the board of a company that does digital printing. They're very, very strong in printing digital books. If you get a book from Shutterfly, there's a pretty good chance that we, in fact, printed that for you. Personally, I live in Breckenridge, Colorado. Please come by. My vocation and my passion is my family. I like to play golf, I like to bike, and I like to sail. So, in addition to your entrepreneurial skills are needed by the people that are private equity, your skills are required and needed for this group. And if there's any item I would like you to take away, that I know you've probably been talking to angel investors, you've probably been talking to venture capital companies, maybe even got in crowdfunding, but there is a good place to be today. Maybe it's not for you. It's a good place for me. It's private equity. There's lots of money in private equity today, lots of money sitting on the sidelines, and they're looking for entrepreneurs like yourselves to bring them ideas so they can put their money to work. So some of the people in the room that know me are probably tired of this chart. This is a chart that helps me rationalize what you need to do depending on what kind of business you have. This axis, going vertically, is a measure of your company versus its competitors. If you are very weak, you're down here. If you are very, very strong, you're up here. Going from left to right, I'm looking at market cycles of the products that you, in fact, sell. So we have embryonic startup, a lot of work in this building here, growth industries. Then we go to mature and aging. From a growth standpoint, my view of a mature or aging business is that it's growing about 1.5 to 2 times GNP to decreasing way over here. So if you're growing 3-4 times GNP, I put you on the left side of this chart. If you are growing GNP or thereabouts, you're on the right side of this chart. The essence of this chart is that you want to be here. This is where success happens. The more, and this line I'll come back and explain it, but the more a business and an industry you're in ages, the more important it is for you to be a strong competitor versus your competitor, versus a strong player versus your competitor. When you are aging and the business is decreasing, you need to be what we call the Iceman. If it's in a mature industry, you can't be weak because more than likely you're going to get knocked out. So if you're in this area, I want to explain what this line means. The closer you are to that line, the more important it is that you be efficient. That's what's important. So if you are a startup company or a growth company, really not that important that you be efficient. If you're in an aging business, you gotta be efficient. So if I'm gonna, my focus today is here. So what I would say that the three strategic imperatives that you have if you are the leader of a mature aging business is that the first one is that you want to go north. I call that a northerly strategy. You want to increase your market share. Also, if you're anywhere near this line, you want to be efficient. If you fall on this side of the line, it's more than likely you're going to have to restructure your operations. We see that happening every day in the business world today, where people are in these maturing and aging, they haven't dealt with their business model effectively, and they end up restructuring so they can deal and be more efficient. The third possibility, if you are a mature or aging business, is to move your business to the left. A westerly strategy. Move your business into markets that are less mature. So let's go through some examples that we have seen in recent days, or over even the last couple years. Northerly strategy. How many people are familiar with Sysco food distribution? This is the classical, successful, northerly strategy company. What their stock has done over the years is absolutely phenomenal. Great, great example. The Aetna pending acquisition of Humana would fit that criteria. You think about what they're trying to do in healthcare. The recent meltable airline consolidations, Delta and Northwest, United and Continental, were essentially moving them to the north. I would also say that if you talk to the executives at those airline companies, that part of what they're doing is trying to deal with that easterly strategy. So sometimes that northerly strategy is, in fact, an easterly strategy. And if, look, I live on C21A in United. If you travel a lot, you know what seat that is. They have done a phenomenal job in moving up this chart. And they, and if you don't think they have pricing power, think harder. They have done a great job of moving themselves up. And several of our airlines are now in the strong category, and they're well positioned to be successful companies for a long time. Our automobile industry has not done that. Yes? But it's working. It's working because they have gone north. Yeah. Let's talk about some easterly strategies. Recently, JCPenney's announced that they were going to close 23 stores, one here in Colorado Springs. Classical easterly strategy. Ball Corporation just bought two companies in Ohio that make the steel sealing containers for steel food cans. In that particular case, it's a vertical integration. They're dealing with that easterly line. So we see these things happen all the time. Westerly strategy. This is the trickiest of all strategic ideas, because the skills that make you succeed over here are not the skills that make you succeed over there. You know, the classical example here is Time Warner buying AOL. I mean, what a failure. And that's because generally the culture here is a lot different than the culture on the right side. So, questions on this. Some people like this schedule. Some people, it really makes sense. You got to be a left brain guy or gal. If you're not a left brain guy or gal, you think I'm full of everything. Yes? Clearly, West is a cultural change. And I'm of the opinion when you do that, what's the company that, if you're here and you're buying here, my first point would be it needs to be a successful company. A company here can't buy an unsuccessful company here and make them better. That's a big mistake. So you're buying a company by definition that should be successful. I'm one that say that if you're doing a westerly strategy, I would keep those cultures apart and let them nurture themselves by themselves over time. Don't bang them together. I think that would be a big mistake. Northerly, I think that you can do that within a company. I have less of a concern about that. Absolutely.
So this is a much harder role to move.
Much harder, much harder. I mean, I would say here's a mantra. You know, the mantra of the people here, they may say, it doesn't make, and somebody said this to me earlier, it doesn't make sense to throw any more dollars at this problem. That's a good skill for somebody that's on the right side of this chart. The people that succeed here, consistent, persistent. It doesn't matter that the last time they did it, it failed five. They're still going to throw more money at it because they believe in it. And they're two entirely different leader styles between those two people. One succeeds on the right, one succeeds on the left. Kind of think in the big public world, I can think of with my own life, but you wouldn't know who they were. Do you know? That's good. Good example.
Actually, Microsoft, you can take an Xbox 2 from their traditional business. It was very, very traditional. They started doing an entrepreneurship program to move to the best. They wanted innovation in how they acquire technologies and change innovation. So they kept separate businesses.
I think you have to. I really think you do. Yes? And you know, Skunk Works is
Excuse me, could you repeat the question so I can get it videotaped up here?
I apologize. somebody just brought up the point about Skunk Works within companies on the right side. And I think that has been a successful model within right side companies to grow things more quickly by having Skunk Works and the culture, the behaviors that are allowed in Skunk Works are very different than what's on the right side.
We haven't seen whether it works or not yet, but here in Colorado, the big beer companies buying the local craft beers.
So that everybody heard that is that there's a challenge within some of the local beer companies who the larger companies are buying some of these small ones. We don't know if it's going to work, but they do seem to be keeping them separate.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. So just quickly, the skills that you want to have here. You want to go north. I'll go work on a chart since I've spent a bit of time on this. If there's a comment I want to make as I go through the next few slides, it's that in either case, if you're on the left side of this chart or the right side of this chart, entrepreneurs are there. Entrepreneurs is a skill that goes across that. Many people believe that entrepreneurs are only for embryonic and growth companies. It really is not the case. So the strategic imperative to increase your market share going north, I would argue you need marketing skills, you need technology skills, because today marketing is so driven by technology, and you need M&A skills. So I would ask the people in this room, do you have these skills? I think many of you probably do. Let's go to the strategic imperative to be efficient, dealing with that line that goes east to west. You need to have technology skills. Clearly, this has been driving the economy in our country and several others. Lean manufacturing Six Sigma, a great example of how we've taken a process and we've made manufacturing so much more efficient. Operational and financial controls. On that right side, you normally do have a fairly strong CFO function in those companies. And increasingly, the leadership of those companies, of the successful companies, were in fact financial people that kind of grew up a little bit like Keith. When you think about it, but people that had that financial background but were able to deal with that. So it's a very important skill. And again, I would say M&A. You know, buy a company, close one facility, rationalize. It's a very, very easy way. Nothing's easy. It's a very effective way, if implemented properly, to be more efficient. The strategic imperative to reposition into less mature markets, technology, marketing, sometimes M&A, not always, but sometimes you may need M&A. Again, I would ask this crowd, do you have these skills? So I've said these are the most three important, and they're in every one of those strategic imperatives. I would argue that the other skills that I just talked about don't necessarily need to be in the leader. I think you can hire the people, bring in the right people to help you make sure that you're successful with those skills. So, last question. If you have these skills, I have an idea for you. Okay? And that idea is to do a roll-up. Very, very nasty name. Oh, I would imagine that people on the left side, they think I'm talking about really bad things. Roll-ups are good. There's many successful roll-ups in this world, and the ones that are most successful, you don't know it because they really are being that successful. So the key factors in this area, and there's been some several studies going over the years. There's one, he's actually a friend of several people in this room, was done by a fellow at Booz Allen Hamilton many years ago. And his name is escaping me at this moment, but I'll remember who he was and I'll tell who it is. But he did a lot of study at Booz Allen Hamilton about what made people successful. Paul Kasurik, who is now doing a roll-up in Indonesia of banks, by the way. So an interesting man. So there are many failures, there are many successes, but studies would show you that those people that succeeded in these areas have followed these rules. The first one is driven by strategy. And that's what we just talked about, those three strategic imperatives. The second one is that you purchase properly. And that has a lot to do with value. It has something to do with culture. I'm going to spend some more time talking about value. Rigorous implementation. Most people think the day they close the deal that the deal is over. The deal has just started. That's when the work needs to get done. And this is the area where most companies fall down when they don't have a very detailed implementation plan for the acquisition. And I would add this, and this comes out of our friend Paul Kasurik, is that people that over time purchase companies, the ones that are successful, I mean, they're not just doing it once, but they do it multiple times, that nobody has ever been successful doing multiple acquisitions unless they've been able to go to their customers and say, this is the benefit of being big. If you can't answer that question in front of your customer, this is why this acquisition is good for you, Mr. Customer, that you need to have a good answer for that. And when you do, it means a lot. I am going to give you an example. Early in our career, several people in this room, we did some benchmarking of people that were successful serial acquirers. And I mentioned their name before, Cisco. We sat down with the management of Cisco and went through what made them so successful. So, and they were buying up companies here in Denver. I guess it was Noble Food Systems, one of their many successful acquisitions. But as we got into the details of what made that company successful, is had to do with private label merchandise. So there is, Cisco is a distribution business, right? It's buying Heinz ketchup and selling it. It's going to a meat packer, buying it, and then selling it and distributing it. But somebody came up with the idea is, let's come up with a Cisco private label ketchup. Probably everybody has seen one. It's probably if you go to most of the food stores, or not food stores, but most of the chain restaurants, you'll actually see on your table a little Cisco ketchup bottle. Well, Cisco used their purchasing power to buy that product at a lot cheaper than they buy Heinz 52. They took that benefit and they passed some of it on to their customers. And effectively, over time, they were able to take private label sales to about 50% to what was in their distribution system. You know, I don't have to tell the people in this room, if you're able to buy a product at 10 or 15% less, and that becomes 50% of your cost of goods sold, that you've just made a grand deal. So there's a great example of because they went to their customer and said, you can buy it cheaper. But they put some of that money in their customer's pocket, they put the rest in their own, and the stock has been a huge success over the years. So that's a great example of a serial acquirer bringing the benefits of acquisitions to the their customer base. Questions? Okay, so I agree with you that employees are very important. If I was doing a more detailed, not a primer, I would talk about one of the major steps in an acquisition is a communication program. Many times forgotten. And that communication program should be a consistent message across customers, suppliers, employees, community. And many times it's not done. I mean, sometimes I go into a company and they told me they bought a company last week and never told anybody. Not a good situation. But yes, the answer is absolutely yes. However, there are exceptions and about how a acquisition may impact an employee base. And that would be when you have that efficiency one, where somebody's buying a company to rationalize production. In that particular case, it may not be good for all the employees. The lesson learned that we would bring forward is that your employees know that and tell them that the day you announce the acquisition. Don't hide it from them. And we would say put in stay bonuses, treat your people well, because if you're a serial acquirer, it's going to happen again. But there are times when it's not good for employees, but I think you've got to be honest with them and tell them up front.
Yes. So a good example of M&A, similar name of the technology company, Cisco, right? So their strategy to move west was constantly buying smaller technology companies. And John Chambers said for years that their core competency was M&A. It wasn't technology. Yeah. So they had the benefit statement going to their customers saying, hey, we've got the latest technology that's being started by engineers, and we're buying that up to be able to bring it to market. And the value statement to the people being bought was, we're going to give you all the money you need, and we're going to leave you alone.
So I mean, yeah, Joe's point there was that the other Cisco is a great example of people buying serially all the time companies on the left side to make things, you know, and to create value. I will tell you, I haven't done this analysis, but when we did do that analysis, Cisco with an S was a better performing stock than Cisco with a C. Over a very long period of time.
Question, if I may.
Please, yes. I don't know if it's five. So the question, are there five things that should be incorporated in the implementation plan relative to both both sides of a transaction? Communication is one of them. As an executive in charge of doing acquisitions, I always wanted to have an executive in charge. That somebody, because I was a CEO, I wanted to have somebody who's total life was dedicated to making sure that this acquisition got done properly, because nobody can do it on a part-time basis. I once spent a couple of days with Carly Fiorina just after she had purchased Compact, and she had three mantras. And by the way, a very, very intelligent business person. And her point was, one, customers come first. Secondly, manage to the plan. And third, customers come first. very, very articulate. Too bad the people there didn't buy into her vision. But it's sort of things like that. I'm sure I could come up with a bunch more. Okay. So I'm going to talk about value for a business. And one of the reasons why people, oh, buy acquisitions don't work, is people overpay. They get excited about the deal. In the business I am now in, when we have problems, we put them off until we just close the closing. Because both people now are getting excited about the acquisitions, and they tend to be a little bit more pliant relative to things that they have. And many people overpay, and at the last minute they don't go back, and this would be another item, don't go back and go through deal economics just before they close and make sure that all their due diligence has supported the assumptions that they put into their business model. So a little bit about value, which is where huge mistakes are made. It is a combination of qualitative and quantitative factors. The quantitative factors drive a point estimate of what you should pay for a company, and then the qualitative ones are about a plus or minus off that. I'm going to say plus or minus 20%. So, quantitative factors, like it or not, on the right side of that chart, companies are purchased off EBITDA. I can tell you all the reasons why EBITDA is the wrong number to be paying. I can come up with a better one. Doesn't matter. That's what the world looks at. So, it's an EBITDA. Then there's an EBITDA multiple. The EBITDA multiple is a function of your top line growth and your bottom line growth, historical and projected. Industry growth rates are just as important as individual company growth rates. And then interest-bearing debt and funded debt comes in. So let me give you an example. So we have a company that has $1.5 million of pre-tax income. Depreciation and amortization is $1.2 million. Interest expense of $200,000. And there's always some pro forma adjustment. So we have earnings before taxes, depreciation, amortization, and interest. That gives you something called EBITDA. Everybody familiar with it? Everybody hate it just as much as I do? Some people tell me, I don't care about EBITDA because I'm not going to sell my company. Then don't talk to your bank, because that's all they want to hear. One of the metrics put into the Economic Recovery Act that is now dictating what's going on in bank, there's an EBITDA metric in it, so you got to live with it. Okay, how do you get, what's the value of the company? Well, you take your EBITDA, multiply as a multiple, I'm going to talk about this a little bit more, and you come up with a concept called enterprise value. Enterprise value is the value of your company excluding cash and excluding debt. So that means you would add debt to it, or you subtract debt from enterprise value, and add cash. So enterprise value, you got cost of doing a deal, you subtract your interest-bearing debt. I'm not talking about accounts payable or accrued liabilities. I'm talking about interest-bearing debt. You add back cash, and that's the value of your company. People make huge amounts of mistakes on this. So what in fact drives an EBITDA multiple? It's all about growth. The faster your company is growing, the higher your EBITDA multiple be. If you're not growing, you have another problem. So here's a model, and you could do this model multiple different ways. So we looked at a company that had 12% EBITDA margins. We assume that 3% of cash, 3% of sales was maintenance CapEx. And I would argue that EBITDA minus maintenance CapEx is a better measurement of value than, in fact, EBITDA. So if you have a company that doesn't need a lot of capital to keep on running it, it's only human capital, you would tend to have higher multiples. If you're a company like the one that several of us came from, printing and packaging, where you're investing in big machines, you tend to put a lot of your money, a lot of that EBITDA back into the business. We're assuming that you can leverage the company 3x EBITDA at the senior level. fairly standard today. The good news is banks are lending again, and you can pretty much borrow in a mature industry 3x EBITDA at a senior level, and that somebody is looking for a 24% return on capital, about where most PE firms are today. If you plot that over different times and you look at different growth rates, this is the multiple that you could pay and still get that 24% return. So the right side of the chart that I'm in is really in this area here, you know, 3 to 8 or 9x EBITDA. When you get here, you start to see companies trading as a multiple of sales. You know, this is about an 8 or 9 multiple of sales if you go through the mechanics. This is embryonic and growth numbers are up here. This is where we are. So if you find somebody is paying 10, 12, 15x EBITDA for a business that is growing 10 to 15%, they have paid too much. The dog don't hunt. That's an expression from Southern New York where I grew up. So it's just not a science about this. And if you're involved with a PE firm and you think that you can be a sponsor and start to pay people 8, 9, 10x EBITDA, the private equity firm is going to tell you to go jump in the lake. So off that number, you have pluses and minuses. And these are the sort of qualitative factors that impact EBITDA multiples. The capacity of the management to do more things. If you have up-to-date technology, that's going to improve. If you have behind-the-date technology, that's going to hurt you. If you have above-average operating margins, that tends to increase the value of your multiple. Effectively, because you keep more of your profits. That's really how it works. You have a good people culture. Buyer synergies. If there is a factor that drives up an acquisition of a company, it's in fact that somebody comes in, they want this business, and they overpay, but they overpay because they have synergies. In my business, I love those people. And if anybody knows any of them, just let me know. I'll pay you a fee. Competitive process. Lots of studies would demonstrate that if there's more and more people involved in a transaction, the price of the company will go up. Negative customer concentration, that will hurt your value. If there's a union, that's going to hurt your value. We have a big problem in America today where it's going to blow up, and that is union pension plans are even more underfunded than the ones that are in Chicago, government workers. And different, in 1974, long time ago, there was a law written that said if that company, if a multi-employer union pension plan is underfunded, the people that are still in that union, the employers in that union, have to fund the shortfall. Not the pension guaranteed and benefit corporation, not the government, other union employers. It is blowing up in corporate America for union companies. We are finding that the union owns the company, not the owners, because the value of that unfunded pension plan is more than the value of the company. Exiting management. If the people that are running the business are leaving, that's going to hurt value. If the people that are running the company and are staying and they don't want to put any money back into the company, that's going to hurt value. You have up and down performance, that's going to hurt. And if you can't grow your business, that's going to hurt as well. So they're just qualitative factors that can impact a value of a company plus or minus 20%. Okay, I didn't hear the rest. The question was, do I take into account book value? So the answer is to some extent. if a company is reasonably profitable, any of these formulas is going to dictate that there's new goodwill being put into the new company. So the 3 or 4 times EBITDA in most cases is going to be more than the book value of the company. There are some buyers that won't do that because of the new accounting rules and having to write off goodwill. But generally speaking, people that are buying successful companies know they're going to put goodwill on their balance sheet when they buy a company and have to deal with the new accounting rules, not so new anymore. The book value has less of an impact on value than the collateral value of what's on the books. What's more important in getting the leverage number that I talked about is how good are those receivables, how good are those inventories, and the property, plant, and equipment, what kind of liquidation value that they have. That tends to be different than book value, but they do come in to how much somebody can pay because it's a function of how much they can leverage at the senior bank level. Okay, so the question is, if we're taking into account the market value of the assets, why are we taking into EBITDA? Because if the earnings power of the underlying assets are greater than the liquidation value of the underlying assets, the income value of the assets wins. It's a higher number, and that creates goodwill. No, we're concentrating on the return of the equity that got put into the deal. What's that return? I'm almost done. I know I'm getting late. So what can you do? Here is the plan that I would lay out for the people in this room who feel, you know, maybe moved by this. The first one. is to develop a strategy that creates value. And how you create value, we just went through that. And you have to explain this to an investor. How you're going to increase EBITDA, how you're going to decrease debt. And secondarily, I would talk about a concept called arbitrage. I didn't explain it before, but a bigger corporation doing the same exact thing, they're higher than multiple. It's supply and demand. It's easier for me to get a $100 million deal done than a $2 million deal done. That's the nature of today's world. So larger companies have higher multiples. So if you're a public company that even has another multiple expansion, you can be selling to your shareholders at 1 EBITDA multiple, but in fact you can buy companies at a lower EBITDA multiple. In the heyday of the 90s, I can remember Keith and I being on the phone, and I would do the quarterly conference call, and we would tell the analysts in New York that this is our numbers. And they would all say, good, Mr. Reilly. And then they wanted to know, what are the sales of the companies that you have under letter of intent? And if that number was high, stock price went up in the middle of the conference call. Then they would ask us, what is the number of the sales of the companies you are talking to? Not that you have a letter of intent, just talking to. And if that number was large, the stock went up even more. And then we added a third one, and that was, what were the sales of the company I drove by on the way to work today? And it even went up further. But the truth of the matter, there is, in the PE world, people will talk to you about arbitrage, where your company has a value of one, and you're able to buy a company at a value of less than one. So, I mean, just quickly, these are some of the strategies, specific strategies that work in a roll-up scenario. You're offering one-stop shopping, solution selling. In this particular case, if because you have the benefits of being big, you're providing your customers with a better product offering, your sales grow more quickly. You expand into new geographical markets. Vertical integration, that Ball Corporation example I just talked about. Offering a differentiating product and service offering. Another example that would go through the filters of a PE firm. Capacity, facility, resource rationalization. Offering defendable savings to the customers. I gave you that Cisco example. Great, great example of being able to do that. Procurement synergies. The more you buy, the more leverage you have with your suppliers. A big, big part of a roll-up and the advantages that you can bring to the shareholders of your company. And the last point I would make is you always need to be in a position to explain to your customer base what are the advantages of this transaction. Going through, so you come up with your business plan. Then I'd like you to introduce that business plan to a private equity. Identify some targets. Demonstration the creation of value. Be willing to invest your own money. But it doesn't have to be a lot of money. It just has to be significant money for you. You know, you may need help. Somebody like Philippe here can help you in putting together this plan. But how you present your business model in an embryonic company or a mature company is very, very important. The better you put it together, the more likely you are to get the money. More than one. Most private equity firms, they want to put money in, but they want to put more money in. So you want to talk about the multiple targets that you would have. And then you go and contact targets, try to put together a deal. You'll be surprised at how PE firms will love you when you bring that deal. They'll like you when you do this. You bring the deal that they can invest in. They'll love you. Okay, let me just summarize. Entrepreneurship has nothing to do with embryonic companies. You need it throughout business cycles. Key factors for success in a mature company is to grow market share, be efficient, market repositioning, moving to the West. The key skills you need, technology, marketing, M&A, and just don't forget, PE firms are a great source of capital. Looking to park money. Final list of questions. I don't know how I am with time. I've probably gone too far.
We have time.
Do we?
A couple more questions. Do you feel like these rules apply to pure technology companies and their value?
The question is, do you think this applies to poor technology companies? I think I wouldn't say technology or not. If I was explaining more the left and right side, When you're towards the end of the growth stage and getting into the mature, you're in an area where the business model has been proven and scalability has been proven. So if your technology idea is beyond that stage, then I do think a PE firm is a place to go. If it hasn't, there's still more development work to do. You don't have a cadre of customers using that technology. And I'm not talking about beta. I'm talking about you've got real customers who are paying the SaaS fee or whatever revenue model you have. If that has happened, PE firms are there. In fact, there are PE firms that's all they invest in. And they're getting so specialized, we see technology companies in healthcare, PE firms. So there's a lot of money in that area.
One more question. Zaman.
Yes, sir. So, Paul, last 10 years you've been working with a number of small companies. You've seen varieties of levels of management. From that experience, when you manage big companies, what would you take from there that maybe you made a decision or an indecision that you think I could have done differently? What would that be?
Good question. So everybody here, he wants to know something. Imani has asked me, was running a large company. Now I've been assisting small companies. Now what you have learned, would you have done something differently? And for those people that know it, I probably would be tougher. Sounds terrible, but some people I trusted over the years, they didn't earn the trust. I started off trusting people, and maybe I would have been better off if I would have had people earn that trust. And when you are a small businessman, you see it because they can't make that mistake that you can make in a big company.
That's probably true overall. As you get older, you don't trust as much as you used to.
Oh, no, it's not the old word.
thank you very much, Paul. I appreciate it.